Today, we're doing something a little different. We're not just discussing economic policy, we are putting three very common ideas into a kind of mathematical test chamber.
Exactly. We always hear politicians debating, you know, should we spend more on infrastructure or should we give everyone a tax cut?
Right. And today we're going to see what the actual math says about which one gives you more bang for your buck.
And we're diving right into the engine room here. This is the, well, the classic Keynesian model.
Mm-hmm.
We've got a really clear case study from a listener, complete with all the numbers.
And our mission is pretty specific. We have an economy with an output gap of 200 units that we need to close. We're going to compare three different policies, and they all involve the number 50. The question is, which 50 is the most powerful?
It's a great question, because your first thought might be, well, 50 is 50, right?
Exactly. But we're about to see how one single assumption about human behavior, just one number, changes everything.
So let's unpack this. To solve the problem, we first have to really define the economy we're working in.
Okay, so what's the baseline?
We have a few fixed values. Think of these as the constants. Investment, which we'll call I, is set at 300. Government spending, G, is 200. And taxes, T, are also fixed at 200.
Okay, so those numbers aren't changing on their own. But there's a dynamic part, isn't there? The part that really makes the economy tick.
Yes. That's the consumption function. And the formula we've been given is C equals 100 plus 0.75 times disposable income. And that 0.75 is probably the most important number we'll talk about today.
The 0.75, that's a marginal propensity to consume, or the MPC.
That's it. It's the behavioral bedrock of this entire system. It basically means that for every extra dollar someone gets, whether it's from a raise or, say, a tax cut,
they spend 75 cents of it.
They spend 75 cents, and just as importantly, they save the other 25 cents.
And that 25 cents, that's what economists call leakage, right? And it leaks out of the immediate spending stream.
Precisely. And that leakage, that 25 cents, is going to be the exact reason why our three policies have such wildly different results. The whole thing hinges on that.
Okay, so with all those numbers in place, where is this economy right now?
Well, you plug everything into the big aggregate demand equation, you solve for the equilibrium, and the sources tell us the economy's current output, its Y star, is 1800.
1800. But we know it could be producing more. The goal, the full employment output, is 2000.
Exactly. So that's our problem. The gap between where we are, 1800, and where we want to be, 2000.
A deflationary gap of 200 units. That's what we have to fix.
And this is where the magic of the multiplier comes in. We don't actually need to find a policy that injects the full 200.
Because the initial injection gets multiplied.
It gets multiplied. And with an MPC of 0.75, the formula for the spending multiplier is 1 divided by 1 minus 0.75.
So 1 divided by 0.25, which is 4, a multiplier of 4.
A multiplier of 4. So to get a 200-unit boost in the economy, we only need an initial kick of 50. Because 50 times 4 is 200.
Okay. So our target injection is 50. Now we can finally compare the policies. Let's start with policy A.
Policy A. This is the most direct, the most powerful tool in this whole toolkit. It's a direct injection of government spending. The government just decides to spend an extra 50 units.
So this could be like, you know, building a small bridge or hiring a few more teachers. How does that 50 work with the multiplier?
Well, this is the purest form of stimulus. That entire 50 immediately becomes part of aggregate demand. It's paid out as income, and then the chain reaction starts.
And since we know the multiplier is 4,
the total increase in output, the delta Y, is that initial 50 times 4, which gives us a boost of 200.
200, wow, so that's a perfect fix. It lands right on the target and closes the gap completely.
It's a surgical tool.
Yeah.
Every single dollar of that 50 goes straight into the fight,
yeah,
maximizing the multiplier. It is, in this model, the highest bang for your buck.
Okay, so that's our gold standard. But, you know, in the real world, the political conversation so often shifts to tax cuts. So let's look at policy C, the tax cut.
The indirect injection.
Right. What happens if the government, instead of spending 50, decides to cut taxes by that same 50 units?
This is where things get really interesting, because the efficiency just drops right off.
Why? I mean, it's still $50 going into the economy, isn't it? I would think the multiplier would still be 4.
But it's not. And the reason is that leakage we talked about. The money isn't going directly into demand. It's going into consumers' pockets first. And for that, we need a different formula, the tax multiplier.
And that formula is different.
It is. The formula is negative MPC divided by 1 minus MPC. So with our numbers, that's negative 0.75 divided by 0.25.
Which gives us a multiplier of negative 3.
Exactly, negative 3. So you take the tax cut of negative 50, you multiply it by the tax multiplier of negative 3, and the total boost to the economy is only 150.
150. So that's not enough. It leaves a 50-unit gap.
It falls short. And this is the key moment. Why did 50 in spending give us 200? But 50 in tax cuts only gave us 150. Where did that extra 50 of impact just vanish?
It has to be that savings leakage, the 25 cents.
It's all about the leakage. But it happens right at the beginning, even before the multiplier process really gets going. Think about it. The government gives you a $50 tax break. What's the very first thing you do?
Well, according to our model, I save 25% of it.
You save 25%. So a quarter of that 50, which is 12.50, immediately goes into the savings jar. It never even enters the spending stream on that first round.
So the initial kick into the economy isn't the full 50, it's only 37.50.
Precisely. And since that initial push is smaller, the final result is, you know, proportionally smaller. You only get 150 in total output. It really shows that where you place that first dollar is absolutely critical.
That is a huge lesson. If your goal is just pure, fast stimulus, relying on consumers to spend all of a tax cut is, well, it's a mathematical error if they save anything at all.
It is. It connects directly to those real-world debates. Are stimulus checks better, or is infrastructure spending better? It all comes down to what you believe that MPC is. How much will people actually spend versus save?
Okay, so we've seen a perfect 200 and a less perfect 150. Now for the third option, policy B, which you often hear about from people worried about the national debt.
Yes, the balanced budget approach. This is the fiscally cautious option. The government wants to provide a stimulus, but it wants to avoid going into deficit to do it.
So they increase spending by 50, but they also increase taxes by 50 to pay for it?
Exactly. Delta G is 50, and delta T is also 50.
On paper, that just looks like it cancels out. You're taking 50 out with one hand and putting 50 back with the other. Shouldn't the net effect be zero?
You would absolutely think so. But what's so fascinating, this goes back to something called the Havelmo theorem, is that the balanced budget multiplier is always, always exactly one.
Always one, no matter what the MPC is.
No matter what. It's a mathematical guarantee. So in our case, the total increase in output, the delta Y, is just 50.
Only 50. That barely makes a dent in our 200 gap. It only closes a quarter of the problem. Why is the effect so small?
Well, we can actually piece it together from what we already know. The $50 increase in government spending, that's the powerful part. That adds 200 to GDP, right?
Yeah, the 50 times 4.
But at the same time, you're increasing taxes by 50. And we know that has a negative effect. A tax cut of 50 gave us a positive 150 boost.
So a tax increase of 50 must create a negative 150 drag on the economy.
You've got it. So you have a positive 200 from the spending and a negative 150 from the taxes. And 200 minus 150 leaves you with
50. That's it. So the reason it's not zero is because the spending is just more powerful than the taxing, again, because of that savings leakage.
That's the whole story. When the government taxes people $50, people don't cut their spending by the full 50. They cut their spending by 37.50, and they cut their saving by 12.50. So the drag isn't as bad as the boost is good.
So this balanced budget policy, while it might sound responsible, is actually a pretty weak tool if you're in a real economic crisis and need a big, fast jolt.
It's incredibly ineffective for that specific goal. It might be a great long-term policy for, say, shifting resources to the public sector without growing the debt, but as an emergency booster shot, it just doesn't work very well.
Okay, so let's pull all this together. This deep dive has really shown us that when it comes to fiscal policy, $50 is not always $50.
Not at all. We looked at three ways to use that 50 unit change.
And got three wildly different results. The direct government spending of 50, that gave us a 200 unit boost. A perfect score.
Then the tax cut of 50, because people save some of it, that leakage weakened the effect. It only delivered 150 in new output.
And finally, that balanced budget move. The spending and taxing effects mostly canceled each other out, leaving us with a tiny 50-unit boost.
The fundamental takeaway here is that the simple act of saving, that 25 cents leaking out of every dollar, makes direct government spending mathematically superior to tax cuts for boosting demand, at least in this model.
The placement of that initial dollar really is everything.
It is. The multiplier effect is the engine, and that one behavioral number, the MPC of 0.75, determined the success or failure of all three of these major policies. We saw that G is just stronger than T.
Which leaves us with a really important final thought for you to chew on. We've been working with an MPC of 0.75 this whole time, but what happens if a really deep recession hits and people become much more cautious with their money? What if that MPC drops to, say, 0.50?
Ooh, that changes everything. If the MPC is 0.50, The leakage is huge, 50 cents on every dollar. The government spending multiplier would drop from 4 all the way down to 2. The tax cut multiplier would fall from 3 to just 1.
So all of fiscal policy would just become weaker.
Much less potent. The government would need a much, much bigger injection to close that same 200-unit gap. It shows that the power of a stimulus isn't just about the size of the check the government writes. It's about the confidence of the people who receive it. It's all about the multiplier it manages to activate.